You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. You give life. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
You broke my chains of sin and shame, and you covered me with grace.
And you mend my life with your holy fire. You cover me with grace.
And you are the hand that reaches out to save. And I am safe.
and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground.
Welcome to worship. I am so glad that you have chosen to be a part of our worship experience today. If this is your first time that you're viewing our worship experience, we welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. We'd love to hear from you. Feel free to contact us by calling our church office or emailing one of the members of the staff. Those numbers and email addresses can be found on the church website. Did want to share one announcement. This coming week, we will be celebrating Ash Wednesday. Ash Wednesday marks the beginning of the season of Lent. And we have two opportunities for you to participate in our Ash Wednesday experience. On Monday, beginning at 6:30, a taped service will premiere on the church's YouTube channel. And then on Wednesday, we will be having a drive-through here at the church so that those who are eager or willing to be a part of it can have the ashes imposed upon their foreheads or on the back of their hands. That will occur on Wednesday from 4:30 to 6 p.m. More information on that can be found as well on our church website. We have gathered to worship God, and so let us turn our hearts and our minds to our encounter with Him.
Thank you. in the house of Mary and Joseph, where he learned the art of carpentry. He must have had rough hands when he began his ministry in the region of Galilee, but he continued to use his hands.
Jesus took a blind man by the hand and brought him to a quiet and still place outside the village of Bethsaida. There Jesus placed his hands on the man's eyes, and his sight was restored. One day, a man with leprosy came to Jesus, got on his knees, and begged Jesus to make him clean. Filled with compassion, Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man, saying, "I am willing, be clean." Immediately, the leprosy left him.
Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good to all. Healing pain and sickness, blessing children small. Washing tired feet and saving those who fall. Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good to all.
As Peter was walking on the water toward Jesus, he began to panic and sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. One day, some parents brought their children to Jesus so he could bless them, but the disciples scolded the parents for bothering him. Jesus became angry with his disciples and said, "Let the children come to me. Don't stop them." And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on their heads, and blessed them.
Jesus took bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it, saying to his disciples, "Eat it. This is my body broken for you." Jesus took a cup, and after he blessed it, he gave it to his disciples, "Drink it. This is my blood shed for you." Also, Jesus knelt down and used his hands to wash his disciples' feet. It was a personal demonstration of his love, an act of service, an example to follow.
Take my hands, O Jesus, let them work for you. Make them strong and gentle, kind in all I do. Let me watch you, Jesus, till I'm gentle too. Till my hands are kind hands, quick to work for you.
One Friday, Jesus' hands were nailed to a cross. But that is not the end of the story. On Sunday, he came back to life and showed his hands to the disciples. Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good for all. Let's celebrate by lifting our hands and praising the Lord.
Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good to all. Healing pain and sickness, blessing children small. Washing tired feet and saving those who fall. Jesus' hands were kind hands, doing good to all. Take my hands, Lord Jesus, let them work for you. Make them strong and gentle, kind in all I do. Let me watch you, Jesus, till I'm gentle too. Till my hands are kind hands, quick to work for you.
Good morning. Let's take a few minutes and talk with God. Join me in a moment of prayer. God of love, we're told in your holy word, the Bible, that you are best described with one word, love. From the time we were little ones through our senior years, we joyously and often sing, "Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so." Are we saying, praise him, all you little children, God is love, God is love. And so many hymns, Lord, devoted to you because of your great love. What an awesome God you are to love us so much in spite of our sins. Thank you for that love. In fact, God, thank you for love in all the forms that you created. And especially today, God, as we celebrate St. Valentine's Day, a day set aside especially to honor Eros love, our romantic love, the wonderful love between a man and a woman. Thank you for the gift of that love. And we thank you for familial love, the love within a family. What a joy, Lord, it is to witness the love of parents for their children and children for their mama and daddy and brothers and sisters for each other and grandparents and aunts and uncles and cousins and the whole menagerie, Lord, that you created for us as our families. Thank you for that love. And thank you, Lord, and we praise you for filio, or the brotherly love, the love of friends for each other. Just as we experience here at Longview with our church family, but Lord, we miss so much the opportunity to be that family with the virus, and we're separated. We ask you, please, as soon as you are, it's in your favor, please get rid of the virus situation for us and help us, Lord. Help us to have our family back together again. But Lord, how good it is, and what a gift to have this kind of love, to have a good friend and a buddy and a pal. And Lord, if we combine these two, family love and brotherly love, and we have the words coming from that of an old song that we all know so well that praises you, Lord. We're glad to be members of the family of God. We've been washed in the fountain and cleansed by the blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this side, for we're part of the family, a family of God. Thank you, God, for family love and for brotherly love. And then, God, in your great wisdom, you created the greatest love of all. And whimsically, I can almost see you now telling the heavenly host, if you think these other loves are great, wait till you see this one. It's my best. And you did do that, Lord. You produced agape love, a love that is selfless, that's sacrificial, that's unconditional, the way you love us. Such a great love that you're willing, such a great love that you're willing to send your own son to die for us and to provide our salvation. And what's even more amazing, Lord, and so much more example of that love is that he was willing to come and sacrifice himself for us. Thank you for agape love. Lord, help us to remember how important love is to you. When your son and our Savior Jesus was asked, what's the greatest of the commandments? And he answered, to love God with all your heart, mind, body, and soul, and to love your neighbor and love others as yourself. Help us to learn how to love one another and to love you with the same love that you have for us. Give us love in our hearts today, Lord. Give us love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Once I stood in the night with my head bowed low in the darkness as black as could be, and I felt so alone and I cried, oh Lord, don't hide your face from me. Hold my hand all the way, every hour, every day,
in this whole wide world that's worse than being alone. Hold my hand all the way, every hour, every day, from here to the grave.
Our gospel reading for today comes from Luke's Gospel, chapter 6, and I'll be reading verses 1 through 11. Hear now the Word of God. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and his disciples began to pick some heads of grain, rub them in their hands, and eat the kernels. Some of the Pharisees asked, "Why are you doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" Jesus answered them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry? He entered the house of God, and taking the consecrated bread, he ate what is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions." Then Jesus said to them, "The Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath." On another Sabbath, he went into the synagogue and was teaching. And a man was there whose right hand was shriveled. The Pharisees and the teachers of the law were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal on the Sabbath. But Jesus knew what they were thinking and said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Get up and stand in front of everyone." So he got up and stood there. Then Jesus said to them, "I ask you, which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to destroy it?" He looked around at them all and then said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He did so, and his hand was completely restored. But they were furious and began to discuss with one another what they might do to Jesus. May God bless the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of His holy word.
Good morning. It's time for our children's message. I can't see you, but I'd like everyone at home watching to raise your hands. Good. Now put your hands down and look at them carefully, really, really carefully. Your hands are very special. What can those hands do? Our hands can tie shoelaces, plant seeds, pet kitties or dogs, write, draw. Our hands can do so many good things. Unfortunately, hands are able to do bad things as well. It's too bad that hands can be used to hit or push people away or write things that are mean. Jesus knows how special and wonderful hands are, and he used his hands to do amazing things. There are many stories of miracles that Jesus performed in the Bible with his hands. In our lesson last week, we learned about a paralyzed man who was dropped down through a roof by his friends where Jesus healed him. He also healed a man with leprosy. He healed a blind man and a young girl who was possessed by demons. In our lesson today, he healed a man who could not use one of his hands. There are so many stories of how Jesus used his hands for healing. He knew how to use his hands to help people and to love people. Today is Valentine's Day. Anytime you see a heart today, I want you to remember how Jesus used his hands to heal people and to love people. Remember how Jesus used his hands to help and comfort and touch those around him. Be thankful for your hands and use them like Jesus did. Let us pray. Take our hands, Lord Jesus, and let us use them as you would have us do. Let us do kind and wonderful things with our hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
What do your hands say about you? This is more than having soft hands or calloused hands, which may reveal the type of work that you do. Our hands reveal our character. At least that's what the American Academy of Hand Analysis scientifically demonstrates. Which of your hands is dominant? Your right hand or your left? Your dominant hand is said to reflect your business and personal qualities. Your weak hand reflects your attitude towards those who are close to you. Every person has strong and weak fingers, and the stronger some of them are, the more expressed are certain character traits. For example, if you have a strong thumb and middle finger on your dominant hand, then you're probably an efficient, responsible, and professional person. The shape of your fingertips is revealing as well. For example, if you have round-shaped fingertips, then you wish to live at peace with everyone, and you fear disapproval. Square and flat fingertips reveal that you are precise and you dislike uncertainty. Even the distance between your fingers say something about you. For example, if your fingers are wide apart from one another, then you are creative and you are fond of experimentation. Now, more could be said on this subject, like your hand strength and your palms reveal some of your health issues. But I've accomplished what I've set out to do. I've made you look at your hands. And as we reflect on today's gospel lesson, let's consider the characters in our story and what their hands reveal about them. The hands of the disciples are working. As they walk through the fields of grain with Jesus, they pluck some of the heads, rub them together in the palms of their hands, separating the grain from the chaff, and they eat the kernels. Having few material possessions and no food on hand, they depend on the goodwill of the farmer or the landowner. And so the hands of the disciples reveal that they are hungry. The right hand of the man in the synagogue is withered. We don't know what caused his hand to be shriveled, whether he was born that way, or if it was an accident, or if it was caused by some paralysis. Regardless of the reason, his hand likely prevented him from working and providing for his family. So he reaches out his left hand as a beggar. He too depends upon the generosity of his community. You see, the hand of the man reveals his lack. Both the disciples' hands and the hands of the man reveal people who are in need. But there are other hands present as well. The hands of the Pharisees. These religious leaders use their index finger on their hands to first point to the disciples. And then they point those same fingers at Jesus. Why are you allowing them to work on the Sabbath? The hands of the Pharisees reveal that they are offended. Their hands accuse Jesus of lawlessness. Then in the synagogue, again, they point those same fingers at Jesus. But this time they discuss how they might rid themselves of this dangerous teacher. The Gospel of Matthew's account even goes as far as they describing them as plotting to kill Jesus. You see, the religious leaders are wringing their hands. Their hands reveal their condemnation of Jesus. Last but not least, we have the hands of Jesus. In response to the initial accusation leveled at him due to the work of his disciples on the Sabbath, Jesus lifts his hand in their defense. Then, in response to the thoughts of the religious leaders in the synagogue who are looking for more reasons to accuse Jesus, Jesus extends his hand to a man with a deformity. And he says, "Stretch out your withered hand." The hands of Jesus reveal mercy, compassion, loving kindness to those who are in need. So some hands reveal physical need, hunger, deformity, lack of wholeness. Some hands reveal offended minds, offenses that lead to accusation and condemnation. And some hands reveal mercy and compassion, loving kindness to those who are in need. But I want you to notice that by his words and his actions, Jesus demonstrates that the Pharisees are also ones who are in need. Metaphorically, the Pharisees' hands are withered because they did not lift a finger to help those who had needs. So this begs a question. As we examine our hands, are they withered as well? I'm not talking about some physical deformity. I'm talking about whether our hands reveal a lack of mercy, compassion, or loving kindness to those around us who are in need. As I look at my hands, I must admit that there are times when they appear to be withered. Before the pandemic, there would be occasions when people in need would stop by the church office. Most often, I would do my best to listen to their predicaments and to find ways to help meet their needs. However, there were a few times that I took offense to them. Instead of taking time to be present with them and attempting to be attentive to their needs, I became anxious and upset internally because they interrupted my work. They were keeping me from completing my daily to-do list. Likewise, there are times when I look at people in need with an accusatory or condemning eye, imagining how they fell into their predicament because of wrong or evil choices. I'm sure many of you have similar experiences when you're in your car and you stop at the traffic light and there's a person standing there with a sign that says, "Need help, God bless." Perhaps there are times that you help. But there are also times when you become offended by their presence. You become internally accusatory and condemning. Like those Pharisees, there are times when our hands are withered, revealing a lack of mercy, compassion, and loving kindness. The two episodes that I read from Luke chapter 6 occur on the Sabbath day. The fourth commandment is to remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. And so we see in this that the commandment is connected to the story of creation. God worked for 6 days, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, to keep the Sabbath holy is to participate in God's act of creation. Certainly, that means that we are to find ways to rest from the hyperactivity that is a part of our lives and so persistent in our world. But I believe it also means that we are to act to meet the needs of others. By helping others, we are enabling them to find rest. We are restoring them to wholeness. And in the process, we are restoring creation to its intended good purpose. Therefore, any act of love is fundamentally an act of creation as well as a way to honor God, even if it occurs on the Sabbath. That was the sticking point for the Pharisees in our gospel lesson for today. This created a tension within them. On one hand is God's command to observe the Sabbath, which they understood as rest, the cessation of work. On the other hand is God's command to love one's neighbor, which requires work. And so in their minds, the two exist in conflict. So which takes precedence? The duty of Sabbath rest, or the duty to feed the hungry and heal the sick? those religious leaders erred on the side of the command to love God with all their being, which included resting their hands on the Sabbath. But Jesus demonstrates a better way, a way where there is no tension or conflict. In the feeding of the hungry disciples and in the healing of a man with a withered hand, both of which occurred on the Sabbath, Jesus demonstrates that the love of God is not meant to be separated from the love of our neighbors. In fact, Jesus indicates that we dishonor God by neglecting human need. In other words, the Sabbath law at its heart requires that we take the initiative to restore those who are hungry or sick to wholeness and health. To refuse to do good, to restore life, is tantamount to a decision to do evil, to destroy life. Therefore, loving God is reflected in our love for others, especially on the Sabbath. So examine your hands. The good news is that Jesus' hands are kind hands. If your hands reveal your hunger, Jesus' merciful hands move to defend you. If your hands reveal a physical deformity of sorts, Jesus' compassionate hands move to heal you, now or in eternity. If your hands reveal a lack of loving kindness towards others, Jesus' hands move to forgive you and show you a better way. The good news is that Jesus' hands can restore your hands regardless of their current state. As followers of Jesus Christ, our hands must do the same. Let us strive to respond to others with mercy, compassion, and loving kindness. Let's offer others another chance. Let's go the extra mile. Let's trust one more time. Let's believe one more possibility. Let's commit one more hour. Let's shed another tear. By doing so, we love our neighbors as we love ourselves, and thereby demonstrate that we love God with all of our being, including our hands. We now move into the time in our worship experience where we offer ourselves to God. And one of the ways that we offer ourselves to God is through the giving of our tithes and offerings to God. It's our gift to Him, a way to show our love and appreciation for all that He has blessed us with. I am thankful for the ways that you have faithfully continued to demonstrate that love to God through the mission and ministry of Longview Baptist Church. And I continue to encourage you to do so. Thank you. But on this Valentine's Day, I invite you to continue examining your hands. What do your hands say about you? If you recognize that your hands can be withered at times, if they reveal that you at times lack mercy and compassion and loving kindness, then I invite you to lift them to the Lord. His hands are kind hands, doing good to all. May the Lord take our hands and restore them and make them quick to demonstrate love to all others. For in doing so, we demonstrate our love to God.
Song of response this morning is called "I Lift My Hands." Please join me in singing as we continue to worship.
Be still, there is a healer. His love is deeper than the sea. His mercy is unfailing. His arms a fortress for the weak. Let faith arise. Let faith arise. I lift my hands to believe again. You are my you.
growing in us. Lord, we thank you that every time we have an interaction with you and trust you and follow the Spirit's work in our lives, that we become your hands and feet and we learn to hear you even more. So God, give us the faith, the courage, the strength that we need to follow you this week, to be your hands and feet. And that's our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.